Hey folks, back for another crypto session, and today we're going to go through a whole bunch of crypto or YouTube comments and some of the videos, but the main thing that I want to talk to today is that trading activity does not hurt rebasing DAO projects. In fact, trading activity helps the projects as it creates revenue for the projects, and therefore the treasury then grows, and therefore it helps the APY and the stakers doing 3-3. In order to explain all that, I need to really talk to you about liquidity pool tokens and how it works. And let's do this. Okay, so I did a few screenshots of some comments in some of the videos. So David Yu said, why don't you leave Wonderland alone and profit from other DeFi? Wonderland is probably the only legitimate DAO out there. You're hurting this community. I do agree with you. Wonderland is awesome, which is why I'm in it and it's why I love it. We'll come on to that. Tyler said, I feel like this strategy hurts the health of the DAO overall. Constant fluctuation of staking and unstaking wasn't the goal of the project. This strategy merely rides the coattails of everyone else who is staking and buying bonds. This is completely not true. When you dump your massive position, you're literally waiting for someone else to come and fix the damage you just inflicted. Not true. If everyone did this, it would collapse. Again, that would never happen. It's like saying, here's something wonderful like Bitcoin that's gone up 57,000,000% in the last decade. Surely the whole world would be on it if it was that good. And that's simply not the case, because everything has a Gaussian distribution of stuff. So if you're looking at, crypto adoption, you'll have this sort of bell curve type thing where you have the innovators, early adopters, minor majority, late majority, and then the laggards. And if you were to then superimpose, the total adoption, it would have like some sort of S-curve thing. And so even with Bitcoin, it's proven itself to be absolutely amazing. Still, there's only there's less than 300,000 users. 300 million users. Even though it's been around, it's just been amazing. So yeah, no one is ever going to do anything. And by the way, I could teach the whole of the UK, every adult in the UK, my strategies. I've only got a few. I just make sure it's a bit like martial arts. You don't learn a billion different combos. You learn three or five different combos and you practice them like crazy. So you can just do them without thinking. That's what I do with trading. Anyway, even if I taught everyone my strategies, it wouldn't dent the market. It wouldn't move anything. It would be like taking everyone to cry into the Atlantic Ocean. And do you think our tears would raise the sea level of the Atlantic Ocean? No, it wouldn't. It's the same with this. Markets are markets. And when there's liquidity. Like a little old Norwich boy, retail pleb like myself, I'm not going to move the markets. There are a few other questions of why are the results covered. So one of my videos was blacked out because I had some sensitive information. You have to understand that presentation was never meant for YouTube. That was meant for the realistic trader community meetups, where it's a nice closed trusted environment. We had only 170 people in that room. They all know what we're doing. We're all doing the same thing. So I do happily share my inner stuff. And this was never meant for YouTube. I just thought, right, YouTube will probably like this. So I put it out there, minus, my personal information. So Uncle Morty, I've seen some of your comments, legend. And if anyone hasn't seen Rick and Morty, watch it. It's like the cleverest cartoon series I've ever seen. It's epic. So if you like science, you like stuff like that, watch Rick and Morty. Anyway, so this is more sort of screenshot type comments. It's nothing fishy. I'm just, as Morty said, I don't want the world knowing every single thing I can do. And also, it's a security thing. I don't want to be actively hacked. So, and I've doxed myself many times. So yeah, this is the main reason for the video. Trading activity does not hurt the project. It helps the project. So to understand that, let's have a little look at minting, okay? I prefer the word minting. It's not, oh my Lord, where's my, let's try and find the deck. So if we go to, the app, Wonderland. Let's It's going to ask me to log in, but I'm not. Okay, so over here on the left-hand side, we have the minting options. And it's basically saying, right, if you provide some Avax Time liquidity pool tokens, you're going to get an 8.69% discount. So the current price, according to this website, is $4,242. But if you can provide some Time Avax liquidity pool tokens, in fact, it's Avax Time liquidity tokens when you look at it on Trader Joe, you will get a lovely discount of 3899. In fact, that's actually a very close entry level to where I got in the other day. So I got back in on Sunday. When was this? The 11th of December. When was that? Saturday. And I was sat in a cafe and I was basically trying to refresh this constantly, because even though it says 8.81, this is a live market, so these discounts are always going to change. So if I refresh the page, it's highly unlikely we'll see 8.81. There we go, 8.75. It's a live market. Anyway, I came across this one where I could find an 8.33% discount with just MIM, not a liquidity pool. The price was $4,200 and I wanted to get back in, and so boom, I gobbled up all of these. So max you could buy, I gobbled all of them up, and then the very next one, because there were none left, because I got them all, it then turned that from a profitable discount into a negative one, so minus 4%. So you have to understand, as in anyone else that wanted to do minting with MIM alone couldn't, because I simply just bought up the allocation. Now, you have to look at the minting side of this like an incentive. This is what the protocol wants you to do. So the way I imagine it in my head, and I think it would be handy for you, is here's you and Wonderland. Imagine Wonderland is a person, or like a robot. Let's call it Wonderland. Obviously, and I can't spell. And you want to get into Time, and Wonderland is doing its thing. So you go over to Wonderland, go, hey mate, I'd like to, you know, get into, I want to buy some Time, but I'm not happy paying the market price of, let's call it 4,200 and whatever, 4,200. Do you do any discounts? It's a bit like going to a market stall and going, you know, I want to buy those oranges, but I want a bit of a discount, mates rates. And instead of Wonderland going, no, go to Trader Joe and just buy the market price, Wonderland will go, actually, yeah, I'll happily give you a discount. And it depends what currency you have. So remember, Wonderland is a protocol and they're constantly tweaking and pruning their treasury. So for example, if you take Ohm, let's look at Ohm. I love June Analytics. It's a shame that it's not on Avax right now. But if you look at something like this, so this is the market value of all the treasury assets in Olympus DAO, okay? I know I'm talking about Ohm right now, but this will make sense in a minute. So the protocol is constantly adjusting based on what coins it wants. So if you look at the composition here, you'll see it's mostly stable coins like DAI, FRAX, LUSD, and it's got a few other bits and bobs. Now, if we just look into this a bit, just open this up, you have to understand that the minting or the bonding part of the project is an incentive thing, okay? It shows you, it's basically telling you what it wants. So if we just get rid of all of these and let's just look at Ether, because I remember not long ago, Olympus wanted to incorporate Ether into the market. And so it did this very tepidly whilst it was testing things out. And then really from sort of the 25th of October, it was like, right, boom. ETH bonds are live, and it was giving really good discounts for ETH because they wanted to quickly absorb a huge allocation of Ether. And look what happened in the space of really from end of October to the end of November, it went from pretty much a standing start to, you know, what is this? The very peak of this was $179.5 million of Ether. So really, in a month and a bit, it went from zero to $179.5 million. So Wonderland is also doing the same thing. Annoyingly, we don't have any good analytics other than this page here. If anyone knows of a good analytics one like we have for Ohm, please let me know, because I'm a numbers geek and I want stats like this. And so looking over here, we can see that Wonderland is trying to tell us what it wants. And right now, when I look at this, if I refresh it one more time, Wonderland is telling the world that it would like more Avax. So not only Avax, it wants time Avax. Now why? Why does it want this liquidity pool token? So going back to this example, it's going, yeah, if you have any Avax time LP tokens, I'll give you a nice 8% discount, let's say. Okay, and just for easy numbers, let's call that 3,800. Okay, so yeah, you can buy time at 3,800 so long as you pay me in Avax / time LP, liquidity pool tokens. And in your MetaMask wallet, when you do it, it'll actually be known as JLP, which is Trader Joe liquidity pool tokens. So why? You have to always ask yourself why. Now, the reason being is that if you were to create a liquidity pool token, basically the easiest way to do it is you have 50-50. So if you've got, I don't know, $10,000, okay, and you want to buy into time, and you want to do it this way via the Avax time LP, you have to go and buy $5,000 worth of Avax, then you need to go out and buy $5,000 worth of time, and then you bond them. You basically, you tie them in together and you create a JLP, a Joe liquidity pool token. And the unit you'll get is like 0.0000, you know, whatever number for whatever JLP. And what this now means is that you are providing liquidity to the Avax time pool. So every time Siam Kid comes along and tries to do a sidestep like me, because I love doing 6-6ing or sidesteps as I call them, and let's say I am buying time via Avax, there's gonna be some fees involved, right? All of those fees, so let's say I pay a whole bunch of fees, and because I really ramp up the gas fees when I'm doing my transactions, because I wanna jump to the front of the queue, I pay lots of fees. Well, I say lots of fees. You know, spending $3 on gas fees for a transaction is a gargantuan amount of gas fees. but it's only $3 when you look at it, and I'd much prefer my orders go to the front of the queue for $3. It's much better than Ether when you're paying between $50 to $200. So yeah, or every time I'm going in and out, well, actually, it depends on what you're doing. Really, when I move my chunk in and out, it costs me about $5,000 in fees to sell my time, and then when I want to buy back into time, it's another $5,000. So for me, whenever I'm doing a sidestep, $10,000 is working its way up to the Wonderland treasury. So you can't say that I'm hurting the project, because I'm not. I'm actually net positive. So with when you have rebasing DAO projects like this, and it's all protocol on liquidity, which is great, it's somewhat of an unnatural market. Natural markets are ones where you have lots of participants all doing all sorts of bits and bobs, and it actually makes it a healthier market. The more traders and the more volume and activity you have makes the market healthier and more resilient. So me doing my thing is actually helping the market, whereas hodling, yeah, I mean, it doesn't hurt the market. It's still 3-3. But it's people like me that is actually giving the Wonderland Treasury revenue. So if you go back to Olympus again, we can actually see what Olympus does. So here, look at the LP fees. So when you look at, you know, that massive shitstorm on Ohm, where we had cascading liquidations of one whale selling a big chunk, which then liquidated a whole bunch of other whales here. So it went from 1,300 down to 600. That was leverage wiping out. That was a leverage flushing. Well, on that one day, or those bunch of days, look how much money Olympus made. It made $1.6 million in LP fees. And even like when you zoom into this, look, if you just take a rough average, just take yesterday. Yesterday, Ohm made $150,000 in fees. This is genuine revenue. Not where minting is or bonding is. That's not real revenue. It's really closer to share dilution, where, you know, you're basically, it's like a company just issuing more shares. That's not really revenue, although Ohm calls it that. This is real revenue, as in LP fees. is making, on average, $150,000 a day, and 90% of that is given to shareholders. So I like contributing to this treasury balance, doing my thing. Now, so the reason there is a five-day vesting period, so yeah, one of the, not the reason, but the, when you do this, you'll get all your tokens, whatever tokens you want at, you know, at this price, but there's a five-day vesting period. And so they're released to you over 5 days. But because you've given them your LP, your JLP, all the fees are going into the Wonderland Treasury. That's why. So, yeah, hopefully that makes sense. It's, yeah. And it's always worth having a little look. Now, by the way, it is a bit of a ball ache being ready on the sidelines with Avax and Time LPs, because... But if, it, for example, if I see a really good Time Avax LP, I'd then have to, you know, sell some position, get some Avax, create the JLP, then come over to here, then obviously log in and do it. By the time you've done all that, this discount could have gone. So, for example, when in Telegram, when I found this, I acted on this. I saw this the second it came out and gobbled it up. And so this is why these prices are always changing. So whenever I'm out of the market looking in, I'm typically sat on MIM. And so I was eyeing up, you know, a lovely MIM thingamajiggy. So yeah, so one last thing before we continue. Sorry, there's two other questions which I just remembered off the top of my head. There's a lot of questions saying that, you know, sidestepping doesn't work, it's too complicated. I cannot stress enough how simple it needs to be. Just look at the base support level. That's it. So, for example, I recently got in and out of a bunch of things. So, if we have a look at Nemesis. So, I was in Nemesis for a while, and then I got out. Why did I get out of Nemesis? I'm simply looking at the base support level. So, if you look at this. There we go. Boom. So, I got into Nemesis. I was riding it up. And all I've done is I just drew this base support level. Nothing fancy, you don't need to be a day trader. I'm not day trading. I'm simply looking at the daily chart, the 12-hour chart. And then, boom, it crashed through, it pulled back. I gave it a day thinking, oh, has it rejected this light level? And then it got out, and then it, yeah. So I sold all of my Nemesis around 4,000 or 3,600. It was somewhere around here, I think it was about 3,600, something like that. I was aiming for a pullback up here, but it never happened. And then guess what? It then crashed big time, and I protected capital. And here it looks like it's still falling. So by getting out of here, I've protected my capital. And as you can see here, if we zoom in, there we go. That was when I got out. It was around 3,600, but it was a bit later than I thought, because I looked at the 4-hour chart and there was a rising compression. And a rising compression in a falling market is textbook continuation pattern. And as you see here, in the apex, it just busted to the downside, like textbook. And so that's why I got out. And I'm not going back in yet. So you don't need to actively be, you know, like a big day trader or anything like that. And there's more falling to come. If you take a look at another one, so I'm in Crown, which is Midas DAO. I'm in a whole bunch of different things, to be fair. So I am going to stay in Midas until, guess what? When am I going to leave? Well, if we look at the daily chart, So ignore that one for now. We are still in definitely in an upwards trend on the daily chart, for sure. Look, that is the base support. I think the 12-hour chart will be a lot better for clarity. As you can see here, this line has been rejected several times. Looking at the 4-hour chart, yeah, it's just caterpillaring up and down this line. So I got into Midas a bit late, to be fair. I got in around here, around $300 ish. Been riding up. I was getting ready to exit, but it got rejected, and I'm still in. However, the moment this level gets punched down, whether it's at this level, I really don't give a shit. When it breaches the support trend line, I'll get out. Simple as that. This is not like super complicated stuff, folks. Connect some lows, draw the base support, And yeah, as I said, this is just like Tesla. Again, Tesla is a regulated asset, and it is illegal for me to talk about Tesla and give any hints and, you know, stuff like that, because I'm not trying to incite a buy and a sell. But all I'm going to say is, look at this base support level. Oh, look, happens to come back to this level over here. You have to imagine there is an imaginary rubber band connecting price to base support. It'll just bring it back. So I drew a little circle over here that got filled, and we got another little circle over here. I wonder if that will get filled because the base support is over here now. Who knows? Who knows? Same with stocks. Again, I can't really talk about this because that again is regulated. In fact, before I get in trouble, I'm going to not talk about regulated assets. Let's have a look at Bitcoin whilst we are here. So Bitcoin looks pretty bearish, and I agree, it is pretty damn bearish. So when we, well, temporarily, that is. So there is for sure some sort of trend line which we're resting on, which is getting awfully close to being breached. I think the weekly chart probably be a better shout for Bitcoin. There we go. Yeah, good old. It's going to be something like that. So if we look at this, I wouldn't be surprised at all to see Bitcoin fall straight bang into this little circle over here around, you know, 45,000, 44,000, and then probably have a bit of a bounce from there. But another way to look at this is going, ooh, maybe we're just having a bit of a Kobo. So we've got a clear level, or we have a clear sort of compression over here. We punch to the upside and we're just doing a Kobo. Kobo is kiss off, where it comes back to kiss off previous resistance, which is now support, and then bugger off. Kiss off, bugger off, Kobo. So it could be doing that. Could be. There's lots of ifs and buts here at the moment, but all I know for sure is that Bitcoin is resting on some huge support level. It's just coming back. You'll probably see, you know, a few further 1,000 points down. That's in turn going to affect Avax. Avax looking really bad, folks. I'm genuinely concerned because this base support. Look, I don't have any. I don't have any indicators. Just simple lines. This is being smothered. Levels that are smothered get broken. Please remember that. Levels that get smothered get broken. So although we had some smothering here, that was in a strong uptrend. Now this level is, we've tried to fight off this level, and not only that, we're having a high test here which is very bearish, and we're getting smothered. We hit that $78, so that's come true. I said back at when it was at 90 we'd see $80. That's happened today. Therefore more falling with time. So this is the resistance level. Oh dear, this looks shit for time. Ah, no. That's not good, is it? Ultimately, I want time to go up. Don't you? Well, yeah, I think we all do. But, yeah, 4-2. Ah, shit. So, looking at time, this has got further falling. Bit like ohm. If we have a little look at ohm, scroll all the way down to the bottom. There we go. I got out 950, and I'm not going to touch ohm at all until it breaches this trend line, whether it's here or here or here or here. I don't care. When it breaches this base resistance level, I'll get back in. But until then, there seems to be a little circle here that needs filling. yeah. Why is that? The circle seems to move, but yeah, it's around this base trend line, basically. I think that's it. Regarding the other thing on YouTube, if I go to my videos, there's a video, I can't remember, but yeah, sidestepping works, folks, it really does. In the space of about 3 weeks, I've turned my time pot from about 160 time to about 330 time. I've more than doubled the amount of time I've had over the last month, really, 3 weeks, 4 weeks. Whereas if you just hodled, your equity would have evaporated half, or halved at least, and you'd only make your, 9% a week. So yeah, just give it a go. It's not hard. Honestly, it's just simple trend lines. It's nothing fancy, no indicators. Look at the daily chart. That's it. There's some comments saying, oh, it's just buy low, sell high and all that sort of stuff. Well, yeah, in essence, but most people try and overcomplicate their charts. Like, the prime indicator of a pretender in terms of charting is when they clog their charts with a billion indicators. So you see it all the time. I can just normally just go down here, like here's an example of one, whoever this person is. Like, when you clog your charts in crap, this is someone leaning on too many crutches. Yeah, I mean, that's not too bad. I've seen worse. I've seen a lot worse. It won't be long until we find someone with a billion trend lines, or a billion indicators. Yeah, this one's getting a bit ropey. I mean, Jesus Christ. Okay, we have a winner. Oh, it's the same person, MBT. This hurts my eyes. Right, I'm going to click off this before I get a nosebleed. Right, see you soon. Hope that helps, and I'll see you soon. Toodles.